ETS started 10 years ago, and the philosophy that drove it to what it is today was the fact that Neil Parsley and myself were working in elite sport, and we wanted to take those practices, what we were doing with elite athletes and sports all around the country and around the world, and we wanted to make that available to the general population, particularly the community that was living on the world. So we started that 10 years ago, and right from the outset there was always the notion that we would grow that into a foundation, into a charity that could take those exact same principles and work with people who are more vulnerable, primarily people who are suffering with chronic illness or disease, and again more specifically people who are dealing with cancer. The objectives of the UTS Foundation is to determine the prescriptive rate of exercise in the wake of or whilst dealing with cancer. What people don't realise is that whilst exercise is encouraged and endorsed, and there's a lot of statistics and evidence and information that support its efficacy, it improves treatment outcomes, and in the wake of successful outcomes through successful medical outcomes, 86% of people are left with debilitating levels of fatigue. And at the 3-year point, 35% of those people are still dealing with fatigue. So what we intend to do is determine the very best prescriptive method for exercise and make that information available to the world. I think the expertise of staff at the UTS across the board is unique, not only within the UK but within the world. We have everything from clinical staff to senior physiotherapists to senior researchers, and we have a breadth of expertise amongst our coaching staff that is unrivaled or unsurpassed anywhere else. We have everything from people who work at the very top levels of sport to who've worked in the most clinical of settings through sports rehabilitation and through world leading research. So I would champion our expertise amongst our staff as world leading. My background is quite multifaceted, really. I've spent a lot of time working clinically. I was a clinical exercise physiologist, and I've worked for the majority of my time in elite and professional sport. And more recently, certainly over the past 10 years, I've spent more and more time embedded in research. And that research is in two parts. I look at the impact of training and recovery for elite athletes, and I've also spent a lot of time in more recent years looking at cancer specifically and looking research around what exercise does physiologically to people who've had or are dealing with cancer, and also advancing that further now into how we can overcome fatigue and into many different methods. In 2 years' time, I hope that the UTS is supporting more people on the Whittle. There's currently 12,000 people living on the Whittle dealing with cancer, which means that in reality there's 40, 50,000 people living with cancer, because it would be one of their relatives, a loved one, family member or a friend. What I want within these 2 years is that we achieve sustainability, premises and facilities, so that we can actually actively support more and more of those 12,000 people. Top tips for keeping fit and well-being: get outdoors, you'll feel better just for being outdoors. Walk every single day, try and walk 2 or 3 miles briskly, get a bit of a move on. On top of that, then we start to move towards exercise. Ride a bike, go for a jog, go for a run. These are all things that are low cost and will get you to be outdoors, particularly people living on the Whittle. We live in such a unique and stunning part of the world. So get out and enjoy it, and you'll feel better mentally, psychologically and physically, you'll feel better. But then you can really start to take your exercise up through the gears depending on what you want to do. So run with more purpose. You should, at some point, every week, you should do some strength work. I promise you now, for lifelong function, mobility, to offset things like osteoporosis, arthritis, make yourself strong. That doesn't mean become a bodybuilder, anything, but do some resistance work. You can do that at home with a bag of rice, or you can come to a gym and get involved. The government should be doing a whole heap more with regards to the obesity epidemic that we're dealing with. Some people like to argue this from various points of view. and I think the argument is redundant. The fact is that we've allowed a social set of circumstances to come about that encourages obesity. We need tighter regulation. If you have a look just recently, poor quality diet has been implicated as the number one reason for premature mortality in this country. So it's surpassed smoking. So let's have a look at what we've done with smoking. We put warning labels on packets. We've prevented the advertising on television. And we need to be strong. We know what we know about food. We know that there are fast food outlets, big global brands that are only making people sick and that are taking them by the hand and leading them towards obesity. So we need warnings on packets. We need labels with tumours on. We need labels that are showing people in and the condition that they can get into. We need things that are showing up clogged up arteries. So that just like with tobacco, when you buy that product, you know exactly what you're dealing with. The sugar tax is a tiny, tiny step on addressing this situation. We need to value exercise more. It should feature as a part of the childhood's curriculum daily, not just weekly, and it should never be forfeited as a punishment or a prize. We should encourage people into the outdoors, and we should be putting mechanisms in place that reduce the financial barrier of people taking part in exercise and sport. That's what the government needs to do. What do I do to relax? Quite typically, I do a lot of exercise, so I like to run. Quite passionate about cycling, roads, so I'm one of the people who clogs up the road for you. Mountain biking, I like to swim, do some resistance training. But I also have a great passion for writing and literature, and I like to listen and play a lot of music as well. Hobbies, probably the one that's outside of all that is writing. I write a lot. Fiction, mostly long form fiction, a little bit of poetry. I'm currently studying down at the University of Oxford, doing a master's course in creative writing, and that's my real passion really. The advice I'd give myself starting off on this career would be to focus more on health sooner. For a long, long time, my main interest was sports performance and being able to equip people to cope better at elite performance. And I think if I was starting out from scratch now, I'd put more and more of the focus on health. Health is what matters. Sport is great. I love sport. Always have, always will. But health matters. So I'd specialise sooner. To summarise the UTS and the UTS Foundation, we're striving to be the difference that matters. We're trying to show people of the Wirral, northwest of England, and really the whole country, that it's within ourselves to look after the people in our community, whether that's supporting them with their fitness goals or helping them to deal with some of the most difficult challenges that life can throw at them. So ultimately, that's what the UTS is about. You can contact the UTS by going to our website, which is www.theuts.co.uk or www.theutsfoundation.co.uk. We have Facebook pages for both the same, or you can contact me directly on utscolin@gmail.com.
A year and a half ago, I was given 3 months to live. I was told to get my affairs in order, to go away and enjoy the time I had left with my family. I've played sport my whole life, became world kickboxing champion in 2009, and this was it. The big C was going to beat me. When I was 23, I had a motorcycle accident. I was run over by an articulated lorry and was told I would never have movement in my leg ever again. Who'd have thought that 5 years later I'd go on to represent Great Britain and become world kickboxing champion? I've got cancer of the brain, a stage 4 glioblastoma multiforme, the most aggressive kind. I changed my diet, I used physical exercise, and I trained harder than I ever had done before. This wasn't just so I could go through chemotherapy and radiotherapy. But it was to attack it at a different angle so I could live my life with my family. I wanted to be a new type of statistic. I didn't want to be sat on the couch waiting to die. If anything, having cancer has made me see the world in a new light, made me appreciate the smallest of moments, no longer just existing. Now the tumour has shrunk. It's shrunk every time I've gone for a scan. I'm back coaching youth rugby, and I'm helping out in the gym, teaching classes, helping to try and mould the next generation of sports stars. I'm actually thankful for my situation. It's like looking at life through new eyes. You've got to stay positive and keep moving forward. I want people to realise that there is hope. There is another option to stand up and take control of their own situation